Well, hey there, everybody. I recently completed the setup of my neon processing plant here, and I have been learning how to process tubes. Over here, I have a few practice tubes I made with that are filled with argon. Nothing fancy, just kind of learning. But I have yet to make a tube filled with neon, and I thought I would make one today and bring you along with me, show you the making my very first neon filled tube. So let's fire up this vacuum pump, make some neon. All right, we'll let that pump down, and we'll go grab some tubing. I have a bunch of old stock tubing here in various sizes and colors, but to keep things simple, I'll just use a couple scraps of 15 millimeter clear glass. We'll also need a pair of electrodes. The one on the right has a 5mm stem called a tubulation, where it will be attached to the vacuum manifold. This blower supplies air to help the torches burn hotter, and propane is used as the fuel. A blow hose is attached to the end of the tube to keep the glass from collapsing while molten. This electrode holder keeps my fingers from getting too close to the flame. After a few seconds in the fire, the edges of the glass are hot enough to stick to each other. Then, using a combination of sucking and blowing and pushing and pulling, the seam is worked until the glass melds together. It is important for the weld to be vacuum tight. It's not the greatest weld, but I can't get better without practice, right? For the tubulated electrode, I cap off the end, then use the same process to attach it to the other scrap piece. With that done, I connect the blow hose to the tubulation and proceed to weld the two halves together. Thank you. Rolling the tube on the table makes sure it stays straight while it hardens. Now that our tube is complete, we'll move on to the processing phase. As you can see, the tube has moisture and contaminants that must be removed before the tube can be filled with neon. To do that, we will hook it up to the vacuum manifold and suck them out. Before I attach it, however, I need to equalize the pressure in the manifold. I close the main stopcock and isolate the vacuum gauge, then use the blow hose tube to slowly admit air into the system until it reaches atmospheric pressure. The tubulated electrode needs to be welded to this 5mm tubing, so I will change it out for a piece that dips down to the level of the tube. A compression fitting seals the 5mm tubing to the manifold. A portable hand torch allows me to take the fire to the processing bench to weld the tubulation. This blow hose will be used to keep the tube from collapsing and to work the weld. In my effort to avoid blocking the camera, I am unknowingly holding the top burner of the hand torch closer to the tube, causing it to be heated unevenly. You can see I almost blow a hole in the side of the tube before I realize the error and reposition the torch. Crisis averted, and the weld looks like it should hold. Now that the tube is connected to the manifold, I close the vent and open the main stopcock for the initial pump down. With the tube under a vacuum, we can test for leaks. This device is called a spark coil. It is a Tesla coil, and it emits a high-frequency spark, high voltage, low amperage. If there is a pinhole leak in the tube, the sparks will jump to it in a bright and obvious fashion. The integrity of the welds are tested to ensure that they are vacuum tight, and everything is looking good. Another way to test for leaks is by closing the U-gauge manometer stopcock and the main stopcock. A leak in the system will cause the fluid level on the right side column to rise. No leaks means we are go for bombarding. I attach the bombarding temperature gauge sensor, then clip the leads from the bombarding transformer onto the electrodes. I turn on the main power to the bombarder circuit, and now we are ready to process. The tube is currently under a vacuum and will not conduct electricity, so to strike an arc through it, some air needs to be added. Closing the manometer stopcock allows me to measure the pressure, and then I use a blow hose to admit a small amount of air into the system. I fire up the bombarder for the initial preheat. The air inside provides electrical resistance, which quickly warms the tube. I heat it until the temperature reaches 100 C to boil off any moisture in the tube. Then I open the main stopcock to let the vacuum pump suck out the water vapor that was just released. After it pumps down for a minute or so, I add more air to the tube. Adding too much air creates excessive electrical resistance, and an arc will not strike through the tube. So I open up the stopcock and I lower the pressure a bit. I strike an arc and hold it, allowing the tube to heat up again. This heating stage will burn off impurities and contaminants inside the tube to create a pure environment for the rare gas we will add later. You can see the color of the tube changing as the impurities are burning up inside. You may also notice the pressure on the manometer is rising as the contaminants are vaporizing. If the pressure gets too high, it will not be able to sustain the arc, so I open the stopcock to bring it down a bit. Also, at this point, the tube is hot enough, but the electrodes still need to be processed, so I lower the pressure to about 1/2 torr. Less pressure in the tube means the electrons can flow faster, causing them to slam into the electrode shells at a higher speed, and this heats the electrode shells. I pull out the choke to send more current through the tube. We need to heat the electrodes until they glow bright orange to make sure the getter on the shells is activated. You can see the color of the electrodes change in the reflection on the table. Again, the pressure is rising in the tube, so I have to suck some of it out. At this point, the tube is getting too hot, but the electrodes are not yet fully processed. Underprocessed electrodes will shorten the life of the tube, so I have no choice but to keep going. I heated the tube too quickly during the second stage, but there's not much I can do about that now. Luckily, this is just a clear tube, so there's no phosphor coating to burn. Next time, I will add less air to the tube while processing. I continue heating the electrodes until I think they are done, then I open the main stopcock for the final pump down. You can see the electrodes are uniformly heated, which is what we want. Now we let the tube cool. After a couple minutes, it has cooled to about 100°C, and I decided to do a flush. Flushing is adding a bit of pure gas and then sucking it right back out in hopes that any lingering impurities will be sucked out with it. I close the main stopcock and slowly add pure neon gas into the system until the pressure reaches about 5 torr, then open the stopcock again. When the tube has cooled enough to touch, it's finally time to backfill it with noble gas. Using the same process as before, I add a small amount of neon gas to the recommended fill pressure for a 15mm tube, which is 9 torr. With the tube filled, we can now perform a quick test with the spark coil to make sure everything is in order before the tube is sealed. Ha! Since everything looks good, it is now time to complete the tube. Once again, the hand torch is used to heat the tubulation in a process called a tip-off. When the glass gets soft, the vacuum in the system causes the tube to collapse, sealing it permanently. This is another one of the many techniques in neon manufacture that requires much practice to master, and clearly, I need more practice. I'd like to get rid of that little hook on the end, but too much heat will cause the electrode pinch seal to stress fracture, so I'll just leave it alone.
Alright, I turned off the air blower. The pump is quiet enough for me to talk over it, so we got the tube hooked up to a transformer, and this is the moment of truth. See what happens in 3, 2, 1. Wow, that's awesome. That is perfect. That is exactly the color we want with no snaking. Ah, yeah. The camera sensor doesn't quite pick it up right. The reflection you see on the table is kind of the color it is. It it's kind of getting the sensor's getting bleached out by the intensity of the light. But yeah, we got that reddish orange classic neon glow. Perfect. That is most excellent. No snaking. Snaking is what happens when there's contaminants in the tube. So looks like we got it processed. You may have noticed it was a little clunky on the. Still need to work on my technique a bit. Also, filming with the cameras is setting up the shots is difficult while you're trying to do something that's time sensitive. So, but anyway, wow, that's great. Many more of these to come. Got a lot of tubes to make. A lot of tubes to make. What? All right. Anyway, thanks for joining me on making my very first neon tube. Oh, man, it's beautiful. Just a couple of little bits of scrap and some electrodes, but it's a great start. Hit subscribe for more neon-related videos, and we'll see you next time.